Whether you're down the street or across the world, you can experience encouragement on demand through the Elevation Church YouTube channel. From fresh sermons to old favorites, there is something to help you strengthen your faith right where you are.
The devil must have got a memo that I'm on to something good. I'm on the edge of Canaan. That's what these giants are here to signify.
Visit youtube.com/elevationonline and take inspiration with you everywhere you go. If you're looking to grow your faith and hear biblical teaching to encourage and inspire you, this is a great place to start. It's as simple as joining us online each week for the live broadcast of our worship experiences, where you'll get to worship, hear incredible preaching, and get to participate in the community of people tuning in, just like yourself. Join us online this weekend at elevationchurch.org.
EFAM is our online family at Elevation Church. It doesn't matter where you call home. Becoming a part of our EFAM is as simple as joining us online each week. Each weekend, we broadcast our worship experiences to thousands of people around the world. It's so simple for you to join the huge move of God that is happening through our EFAM by tuning into experiences on the weekend or on demand when it's convenient for you. When you participate, you'll experience awesome worship music, preaching, and community with people tuning in, just like yourself. You can have a deeper connection by joining an e-group and an e-team and connecting with other EFAM near you through watch parties. Wherever you find yourself in life, we want to be a place you can depend on for receiving inspiration, encouragement, and support. Grow your faith, no matter where you are.
I love Jesus, but I was so broken.
Real broken.
I conquered that. Yep. You in my weakness were strong.
It's all the things, the little things, the big things.
There's something that you've either been through, you're going to go through, that somebody has been through on the planet.
I'm at the right place at the right time.
And I'm praying that your faith stays strong.
It's great.
The pandemic isn't over. Millions of people living in poverty are still trying to recover from the devastation of COVID-19.
People have lost loved ones, their homes, their jobs. Thousands can never go back to the lives they once had. Our mission is to follow Jesus where the need is greatest, responding to crisis and partnering with local churches to bring restoration to those living in poverty.
In partnership with Tear Fund, The Well seeks to encourage and empower those suffering the effects of the pandemic to discover for themselves the tools and the resources they need to recover together.
Please act now. We cannot afford to wait. Text RECOVER to 70122 to give £17 or visit tearfund.org/recover. Your gift could provide a family with health training and food support for 3 months. Give today and let's recover together from COVID-19. Thank you.
Now, the scripture says, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. We are halfway through Declaration 2022, and hasn't it been absolutely incredible? If you're joining us for the first time, if you're just joining this movement, the question is, where have you been? Where have you been? God is truly doing a new thing in this new year. Now, we absolutely love hearing from you, so continue to send in your prayer requests and your praise reports. And tell us where you're watching us from. I want to know what city, what town you're watching us from. And if you are watching from YouTube or Facebook right now, hit that share button. We don't want you to keep this glory to yourself. Well, tonight, we're looking forward to bringing you another amazing evening. Our theme is worship and justice. Markell Wallace is going to be leading us in a time of praise. And Dr. Robert Beckford is going to lead us in an amazing word, amazing message coming from him. We've got Elder Charlotte Reed from Rurak City Church going to be leading us in our national prayer focus. And Dr. Ruth Valera is going to be leading us in our global prayer focus. It's going to be an amazing night. Now, we have received some great prayer requests. We are going to be standing right now. Come on, let's lift up these prayer requests that have come over the last couple of hours. Yemi has asked us to pray to help God, help him navigate this year, because he has experienced a lot of loss in 2021. Wow. Sasha has asked us to pray that God guides her steps in 2022. And Abid from Pakistan has asked us to pray for him as he's experiencing a lot of financial difficulty and he would love to be able to travel with his family. Now, I know there's a lot of people that have lost people. I know personally a lot of people that have lost people in 2021 that have got financial difficulties, that are just dealing with all sorts of storms and all sorts of stuff. Let's begin to lift up prayers. Father, we stand with Yemi right now. We pray for the grief that he is feeling because of the loss that he has suffered in 2021, Father. Let him not be afraid to cry, but let him know that joy comes in the morning, Father. Overshadow him with angels. Overshadow him with your comfort, Father. We pray in the name of Jesus that grief will turn into joy. That joy will come in the morning in Jesus' name. Let him lift up his head and not be afraid, Father, to move forward, Father. Let him reflect and smile. Let him know that joy comes in the morning. We stand with Sasha right now, Father. You said that your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. So for anyone that's watching that feels like Sasha, that needs guidance, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that you give clarity, nimbleness of thought, Father. You bring a vision, Father, in the name of Jesus. Great vision, great clarity in the name of Jesus. Great direction in the name of Jesus. We pray right now for Abid in Pakistan, our brothers and our sisters in Pakistan that are experiencing financial difficulty. We stand with him, Father. Be a source to the resource, Father. We pray this right now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now we know, just like prayer, worship brings breakthrough. Yeah. So let's call on the name of the Lord. Over to you, Brother Markell. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Happy New Year. You've made it out. And that is a good reason to praise God right there. Come on, put your hands together. Make some noise. Woo. Right where you are. We're going to worship the King. Hallelujah.
We're here for you. Let your spirit move as we shout your praise from our hearts to your ears. All the glory is yours now forevermore. Hear our worship. All we can give is for you. We're here for you.
Okay. from you. If you don't come, we won't move. Desperate, Lord, for a touch from you. Say, we won't move. You are King. Say we're here for you. Mighty. He's a way maker and a provider. He's everything. He's the I am that I am. So whatever you need today, just begin to call on him. Just begin to call on him. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. Oh, oh, oh. You mean more than this world to me. So now all of this world I leave. You mean more than this world to me. So now all of this world I leave. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. and for all you are, holy, holy. For all you've done and for all you are, holy, holy, holy. For all you've done and for all you are, for all you've done and for all you are, for all you've done and for all you are, for all you've done and for all you are, for all you've done and for all you are. Holy, holy, holy.
For all you've done and for all you are, my response is holy. Even in this year, my response is holy. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Well, this week is all about prayer, so we're going to continue to pray for you because we believe that prayer changes things. So let's begin to pray for those that have sent prayer requests in, because we're standing on the promises of our Almighty Savior, who is and will continue to be holy. Edlina has sent a prayer request in to pray for the family of Zane, who was stabbed and killed in Croydon. Bethlehem has sent a prayer request to pray for the peace of the country of Ethiopia, and that the Prime Minister leads the country according to God's will. Marie has asked for us to pray for the protection of young black boys, particularly in the UK and the US, who are targeted by the police and wrongly accused of crimes, and to pray for the ending of police brutality. Now, these are some big prayers, but we serve a bigger God. Let's begin to pray for these family members, for these people, for these countries. Let's begin to lift up our voice all over this studio, all over wherever you're watching from. Come on, lift up your voice. God hears your prayer. He hears our prayer. Father, we lift up the family of Zane right now, the guy that has lost his life. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that there be, for people that haven't got answers, Father, that they find answers. For people that are struggling in their grief, that they are able to find comfort, Father. We pray for the systems of this world that cause this brutality to continue, Father, for blood on the streets, even as his blood cries out, just like in the scripture, Father, that you will bring healing, you will bring justice in the name of Jesus. We lift up the country of Ethiopia, that beautiful country, Father. We pray that this year we'll see a flourishing in every industry, every sector, Father, from education to health to transportation, infrastructure, government, Father. In the name of Jesus, its economy will rise, women will rise, young people will rise, the church will stand up in that country. In the name of Jesus, we speak to Ethiopia right now, and we say, Ethiopia, come forth, rise from the ashes, rise from your wounds in the name of Jesus. And we stand with every single black brother and black sister that may be persecuted and wrongly accused by crimes because of systems of this world, and we come against police brutality right now in the name of Jesus. And even though it's a polarizing subject, and even though people are standing on different sides of the fence, we pray that the church will bring unity, the church will bring solutions, the church will bring solutions in the name of Jesus, and there will be change, Father. There will be systematic change, there will be community change, there will be change in families, there will be change in structures, there will be change in the police departments. Father, we pray for unity and cohesion. We, in the name of Jesus, and let the church arise, let the church arise in this season. Hallelujah! Come on at home, lift up your voice and begin to give God a great praise, because we believe that he is able and he's going to use us to do it in Jesus' name. Well, now I don't want to labor anymore. I am joined by the amazing Reverend Charlotte Reed, who's going to lead us as we pray for this nation.
Amen. Amen.
darling.
Shall we give God the praise and all the glory and all the honor that's due unto his name? Father, we exalt you today. We thank you for who you are, God. And we come before you in this prayer against the injustice that's happening in our world, Father God. The Bible says this poor man cried and the Lord heard him and delivered him out of all of his troubles. And so as we come to pray tonight, we believe that the spirit of deliverance is moving beyond this prayer and to your homes, in our communities and in our nations. Father, your word reminds us to defend the unjust, to learn to do good, to seek justice, to correct oppression where we see it, and to bring justice to the fatherless, to plead the cause of the widow. And even in this time, Father, we are mindful of the fact that there are people who have been crushed, people who have been broken, people who have been ostracized, people who have lost, people who are crying tears even in this moment because of what the last year and previous months and weeks have dealt them. But Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray, God, that you would strengthen their hearts. We stand in the gap lifting up their hands as a signal of strength of the Spirit, God, not by might nor by power, but by the Spirit of the Lord. God, we speak to those who have been oppressed, Lord God, through situations and where they have lost in this season. Some have lost their jobs. Some have lost their loved ones. Some people have lost their finances, Lord God. Some people have lost, Lord God, their company, their friends, and been betrayed, Lord God. Some have been dealt harshly, even in their places of work, God. And some people are waiting on some decisions in the courtroom, some decisions about employment, some decisions about their finances, some decisions about their health. But God, I pray that every spirit of oppression would be broken in the blood of Jesus. You are the Most High Priest. You are the great judge. Heaven is your throne and earth is your footstool. And so, God, as we stand in the gate of our nation, we pray that the just cause will go forth in the name of Jesus. Turn the situation around for your glory and for your honor, God. But the Bible reminds us, God, that the hooks are in the jaws of the nation, and you turn it whichsoever way you desire. And so, fathers, we stand believing you are bringing a change in our nation here in the UK. Father God, Isaiah 1:17 reminds us, you've told us, oh man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God. And so, Father, we pray even today, God, that even concerning our nation, concerning our government, concerning those who have been put in places of power, God, we pray even in this season and in this time, God, that they would do justly with their policies. They would do justly with their reformations, God. We pray the judgment of God over every plan of darkness to bring chaos, to bring confusion, Lord God. Oh, Lord God, we speak the peace of God over our nation in the name of Jesus. Use us as your hands and feet in this hour, God. Because our worship, Father, is not just about a song, but it's about our expression, our hands, our feet, our movement, and the way in which we act in the earth. Father, use us for your glory, Lord Jesus. We pray even in this time, Father God, you'd help us to be dispensers of your healing. Help our eyes to be open to the compassion, with compassion to those who are broken. Help us to feel empathy towards those, Lord God, who are feeling challenged and broken in spirit and broken in heart in this time, Father God. And we pray that as you release that healing through us, give us healing words and healing prayers, that it's not just through the activity, but it's also through the prayer that we deliver on our knees, because heaven knows no boundary and the spirit knows no limit. In the name of Jesus. And so we speak even to people in their homes tonight and decree the healing power of God to mend the broken and restore those, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, even in this hour, God. Job 12 reminds us that you reveal the deep things of darkness and bring utter darkness into the light. And so we pray for a divine revelation. Father, I pray for clarity in this time. I pray clarity for those, Lord God, those who have been given organizations, ministries, ideas, solutions, and strategies in this hour to speak to those who are suffering injustice. They may have been trafficked individuals. They may have been individuals lured into our nation under the guise of hope, the guise of prosperity. Abused, Lord God, those who are abused in our communities. Those who are immigrants coming from other nations and other places, torn out of their homes due to war and feel like a stranger in a strange land. But God, I pray, Father, that the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, would be with them even now, Father. God, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the advocacy and for those organizations whom you have burdened to be a help in this time. We pray the resources would come to them, tangible and intangible. Money, finance, people, Lord God. We pray there be a release in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Give them the compassion, the heart, the faithfulness, the dedication that's needed in this hour. And I pray for that man or that woman that's challenged in their mind and wondering, God, shall I run with this vision?
Yes, Lord.
A vision that's going to transform, a vision that's going to restore, a vision that's going to build my community. And I want to encourage you tonight to run with the vision.
Amen.
Write it and make it plain and run with the vision in the name of Jesus. I believe God is raising up people even as we are praying tonight to transform and to bring back together our broken communities. We don't have to worry about vengeance because God reminds us vengeance is mine. He will avenge in the name of Jesus. And we pray even in this time, God, that even as you avenge, Lord God, by the power of your Spirit, God, that there will be due justice and due peace again in our land in the name of Jesus. And we decree it, amen and amen in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Thank you so much, Charlotte. Now let's see what else is going on across this week at Declaration 2022.
Praise the Lord, saints. Declaration 2022 is still going strong, and we still have more virtual events over the next couple of days for you to attend.
We do. Morning prayer sessions will be taking place on TFN's Facebook channel at 7 a.m. So join in as Shamara Fletcher and Sarah Jane lead us in prayer.
A special lunchtime workshop will be taking place at 12 p.m. on Zoom. So come along to explore the theology around community and climate.
For even more Declaration fun, tune into Premier Gospel Drive Time Show with eBay Giant Killer. eBay is going to be joined by Harry Finder. He is the co-founder of Youth for Change.
And right after the live show, there's an after party. Cassandra, tell them where.
Instagram Live.
That's right. The after party will be at 9 p.m. tonight with Anna Wooding and Ruth Bellerio. Remember to download the YouVersion Bible app. There's a Declaration Bible Study devotion, and it's just for you.
If you want to get involved and you want to access all these really amazing resources, all you need to do is head over to tearfund.org/thewell.
Amen. Wow, we are absolutely loving the morning prayer sessions and the lunchtime workshops. They are phenomenal. So make sure that you join us if you can. Well, right now I am excited to be joined by Dr. Ruth Valerio, who is the Global Advocacy and Influencing Director at Tearfund. Ruth is here to share with us what is on her heart in regards to worship and justice globally. Over to you, Ruth.
Oh, good evening, Seth, and good evening to all of you in the studio and everybody watching. It's just such a privilege to be with you this evening. And I've been joining in some of the other things this week too, and so enjoying them. So thank you. So we're focusing today around worship and justice. And we've been worshiping and praying, and we're going to continue praying now. And we are going to pray to our God of justice. Psalm 146 tells us that our God of justice upholds the cause of the oppressed, gives food to the hungry, sets prisoners free, gives sight to the blind, watches over the foreigner. This is the God who we pray to, a God of justice. And prayer is a conversation, and I want us to have a conversation with God this evening. As I've been praying for Declaration, I believe that the Lord is wanting to ask us three things through this prayer session. The first thing that our God asks us is do you worship me as a God of justice? Do we worship God as a God of justice? We know him as a God of salvation, of righteousness. But tonight, let's take time to pause, to talk to God, and to ask him to give us a fresh understanding of who he is, to break our hearts for the things that break his. Lord God, we ask that you would show us anew who you are. We can get so stale in our understanding of you, but we have been learning all week that you are a God of justice. And we want to learn what that means, what it means to worship a God of justice. Yes, all of us, God, whether we're in the studio or watching from our homes or out somewhere, Lord God, we give ourselves to you and we ask you to broaden our vision of you, our understanding of you as a God of justice. Secondly, I believe God asks us, does your worship in your churches reflect that understanding of God as a God of justice? The Lord asks you, who does your worship in church reflect? Bring your church to God now. Think about the worship that you do together. Let's pray and ask God that he would transform our worship so that we worship fully in our churches, a God who is a God of justice. Let's talk to God while I'm talking. Wherever you are, talk to God too. Ask him for that transformation in your own church's worship. And then thirdly, the Lord asks you, does your life as a life of worship reflect the God of justice? The Lord asks me, would someone look at me and say, she worships a God who loves justice? Would your neighbours, your work colleagues, your friends, your family look at you and say that you worship a God of justice? Call out to God now and ask him to transform you. Ask him to show you those areas in your life that don't reflect a God who loves justice. So let's bring all of these things together. And let's pray. Let's pray for our churches. Let's pray for ourselves. Let's pray for our communities, that they would look at us and see us as a beacon of hope, a beacon of justice in a world of oppression, in a world that is crying out for good news. Lord God, we lift ourselves up to you. We lift your church up to you. May we reflect you as a God who loves justice. A God who calls us to spend ourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed. Transform our worship, Lord God, that we may worship you as a God of justice and then be transformed and called to go out into our communities and live out and demonstrate the good news that we have in you and in your kingdom. Lord, transform our lives and transform the lives of our churches in line with you as a God of justice. Amen.
Amen and amen. We worship the God of justice. Thank you so much, Ruth, for leading us in that incredible and challenging and charging time of prayer. While we've been receiving lots of prayer requests to pray for those that are suffering from the virus, and to help those that are seeking restoration for their families. We know in the UK that we are struggling in this pandemic, but the truth is that COVID-19 is impacting those that live in extreme poverty the most. So tonight we're going to pray for the Recover Together campaign as it seeks to equip churches and communities around the world during this crisis by providing food provision, training families about healthcare, equipping people for new job opportunities, and so much more. We want to pray for where this campaign is going to reach. Places like Ethiopia, Malawi, Uganda, Nigeria, Brazil, and way more places all over the globe. Let's begin to pray right now for God's provision and God's intervention. Father, we lift up these countries to you right now. We pray for the Recover Together campaign, that as we are generous, as we are praying, as we are giving, as we are loving, as we are sharing the news of this campaign, that where it will reach places, and we will see great flourishing in the name of Jesus. We will see change in the name of Jesus. We will see a revival, a resuscitation of neighborhoods, a flourishing of prosperity in the name of Jesus. And those that believe that God will and God can, shout amen. Amen. Now, let's head over to some great teaching by Dr. Robert Beckford.
It is a pleasure to be with you today. When Seth asked me to come, I made no apology and I said to him I would be here, because I know Seth is doing some great work with you and with The Well as well, which has been publicized on the station. So I think it's all fantastic work, and I want to contribute this evening to the discussion, which is on worship and justice. But I want to start by having you say three phrases. And they are prophet, half prophet, no prophet. So let's say that again. Prophet, half prophet, no prophet. In order to engage in worship and justice, you have to understand what it means to be a prophet in the world today. A prophet is important in the biblical story because in the 8th century, 800 years before the birth of Jesus Christ, Israel is in turmoil. Right. The rich are getting richer, the poor are getting poorer. Injustice reigns throughout the land, and God is not silent. God sees what's happening, and God sends the 8th century prophets, Micah, Amos, Isaiah, to engage with the people, and these are prophets. The problem that we have today, though, is that not everybody is aware of what the work of a prophet actually is. That's why we're going to work through these issues tonight. We're going to work through prophet, half prophet, non-prophet. So what does it mean to be a prophet then? A prophet in the Hebrew Bible has two terms. The first term means seer. And a seer is somebody who is a clairvoyant. They see into the future. So for example, we know that King David goes to see the seer of Gad. And the seer of Gad tells him that in a certain number of years' time, there's going to be a famine. So the seer looks into the future and tells you what's going to happen. Now, there's a lot of people today who have the gift of prophecy, but they're seers. What they will do is speak into your individual life. They'll do what the New Testament says. They'll have a word of prophecy, and they'll tell you about something that's happening within your own individual circumstance. We call this approach forth-telling, telling what's going to happen within the future. But that's the work of the seer. The second concept or term used in the Hebrew Bible for prophet is spokesperson. The spokesperson or nabi in the Hebrew is somebody who doesn't just see into the future. They do what we call forth-telling. And forth-telling means you're speaking the word of God here and now and engaging the social world. You're speaking to the people in power and authority, or the people doing the works of injustice, and you're telling them what God demands from them. So these people are the spokespersons of God, and they're doing the forth-telling, not the foretelling. Now, here's where it gets interesting. Of all the times forth-telling and foretelling are mentioned in the Hebrew Bible, the one that's mentioned the most is the forth-telling. The work of the prophet speaking truth to power and engaging in justice. So what does that mean then? It means that to be a prophet isn't necessarily just about being a seer. It's about doing the work of justice and speaking truth to power. That's the work of the prophet within the world. So anybody who says they're a prophet, these are the things you've got to look for. Are they doing the work of social justice, or are they just doing the clairvoyant work? Because that is the work of the prophet. So what does the prophet do? What kind of work does the prophet do if the prophet is committed to social justice? Three things that the prophet does. The first thing that the prophet does is they unsettle the social order. Think of Micah. Think of Amos. Yeah. Think of the way in which Isaiah says in Isaiah 1:16-7, says to the people, cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, rescue the oppressed. You see, the work of the prophet isn't to maintain the status quo. There is no such thing as a conservative prophet. Sorry, Boris Johnson, it just don't work that way. There is no such thing as a conservative prophet because conservatives conserve. They keep what's happening. A prophet disturbs, challenges, changes the way things are. So look at what the text is asking us to do now. It's asking us, the prophet has to stop the people doing evil. Think of the evil that's out there in terms of urban environments, in terms of brutalization of the children, issues of domestic violence, issues of knife crime, gun violence, economic oppression, racism within the schools and the criminal justice system. The work of the prophet is to address those issues, not just to tell somebody that next week they're going to get a bigger car, not to tell somebody next week you're going to find that partner. That ain't the work of the prophet. The dominant work of the prophet is to engage with these issues, learn to do good, seek justice, telling people that. The second thing that they do, because they disturb the social order, is then they intervene. See, a prophet is not somebody who stays in the background and does not engage with what's happening. A prophet is on the front line. When God sees injustice, God sent the prophets to engage and act. Take, for example, Elijah, Naboth's vineyard. Sees that this land has been acquired unjustly. Sees the way in which the people have been brutalized. The prophet intervenes to ensure that justice takes place. So the prophet is an interventionist force within the world, doing God's work, speaking justice. That's the work of the prophet. They intervene. Makes you wonder then, when people say that they are prophets, they're doing it behind a desk. People say that they're prophets and they're only at the pulpit. That's not the work of the prophet in terms of the Hebrew Bible. The prophet has to be somebody who is interventionist. The prophet should be the one in between the gangs. The prophet has to be the one who's telling the people in power that by having the cuts that they're having, they're brutalizing the poor. The prophet has to be the person who makes sure that within the church context, men so respect the women that domestic violence is an issue which confronts the church. The prophet is an intervener. You cannot be a prophet in word only. You have to be a prophet in terms of action. So the prophets, not only do they disturb the social order by challenging the system, seeking justice, wanting to see change, speaking that justice, they also intervene. The third thing that the prophets do is they affirm the work of justice that is taking place. When we are told in Isaiah that the meek shall obtain fresh joy in the Lord, and the neediest people shall exult in the Holy One of Israel, for the tyrants shall be no more, and the scoffers shall cease, and be all those who do evil shall be cut off. Isaiah's affirming the work of justice. He's saying God isn't silent. God is not sleeping. God sees the injustice. God's not insensitive to the fact that there are climate change refugees traveling across Sub-Saharan Africa at this point because the pollution from this part of the world means that they can't grow their crops. God is not silent on the way in which this government is dehumanizing and trying to desensitize us to the migrants and refugees who are trying to get into this country and escape tyranny, escape injustice, escape climate catastrophe. God's not silent on that. God affirms the work of justice, those who are doing the justice. So the work that you're doing with the well, God affirms that. The prophet's work affirms the good stuff that you're trying to do. The prophets affirm where people speak truth to power and confront the government, speak truth to power and confront unjust corporations. Third thing that prophets do then, you see, they affirm what God is doing, the good work that God is doing. It's the prophet. Half prophet. You see, if people are called prophets and the bulk of the work of the prophet is to speak truth to power, challenge the injustice, intervene, first one on the front line, affirming where goodness is to, well done, government, you've got it right this time. Well done, corporation, you've got it right this time. That's the work of the prophet. If somebody's not doing that work, they're at best a half prophet. Now, a half prophet is problematic. And the best way to think about a half prophet is to think of other examples where you might get half. What if you went to the doctor and said, "Doctor, I've got a bad foot. This is my leg. Doctor, I have a bad leg." And the doctor says to you, "I can only do half the work." You say, "I'm gone. I want a full doctor. I need somebody who can do the whole work." What happens? You send your children to school. So the school teacher, "Did you teach the class today?" So I only taught half the class. That's my Jamaican coming out a bit too fast there. "How come you only taught half the class?" "Because I'm only a half teacher." What if you then went on a plane? You get on the plane, Heathrow. You're flying over the channel. The pilot comes on, ding, ding. "I hope you're enjoying your flight. This is flight 207 to New York, landing, blah, blah. But sorry, I'm only a half pilot. Somebody else will have to fly." You say, "My goodness, it's only," you see, half is never good enough. And somebody who's only doing half the work of the prophet, if they call themselves a seer, they're not doing the work of the prophet. It's the whole job. And here's the problem for the people who are only half prophets. In the biblical tradition, if the prophet is not doing the full work of the prophet, they are no prophet at all. That's a big problem for us. Because you go on the internet and you look at some of the prophetic services taking place. People will say to you that they're doing prophetic work, but it's only the work of the seer. You go to the service, they say, "Next week, your hair will grow back. Thank you, Jesus." I'm just joking, they didn't say that to me. But they're speaking to your life. I'm not diminishing it. They'll say some really important things, but it's only a part of the work of the prophet. The bulk of the work of the prophet is at street level, government level, engaging with the principalities and powers that Paul says we have to wrestle with, that are invisible. Yeah. That's the work. And you're not doing that behind the desk or behind the pulpit. You're doing it out there in the community, in the world. So consequently, we have a crisis. Because the vast majority of people claiming to be prophetic, and I'm not saying they might not have a prophetic gift, they are doing half the work of the prophet, and in the Bible, that's no prophet. In fact, the biblical text even gets harder than that. It says, if somebody claims to be a prophet and what they claim to do isn't the work of the prophet, you're meant to take them outside the town and get rid of them. Because a half prophet is no prophet. Prophet, half prophet, no prophet. So what does it mean for us then when we turn to the New Testament and think about the life of Jesus? How does Jesus become an example to us of what it means to be prophetic? Because if Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith, then it's vitally important that we see in Jesus the prophetic ministry, the prophetic work. Does Jesus disturb the social order? Of course Jesus does. Yeah. Jesus goes to the temple. Turns over the temple, deals with the money changers. Jesus deals with those in power, the Roman authorities, deals with the religious authorities and challenges them. Think, for example, of something as simple as the Lord's Prayer, where we often are taught to think about this as something you eat out on Sunday before you rice and piece of chicken, if you're still doing that. I know you millennials don't do that now. You might be having some takeaway sushi or something like that instead. But back in the day, you know, take away something. But anyway, but back in the day, you see, we used to repeat it. We didn't think about how this was Jesus's way of telling us about what it meant to be prophetic, disturbing the status quo. How does Jesus begin the Lord's Prayer? Jesus begins by saying, "Our Father, a God who is for all." Now, why is that significant? Because in the Old Testament, it's a boys' club. The God of Abraham, Isaac, women don't come into it. Jesus disturbs that gender inequality and says straight away, "I'm a God for all," challenging the way things are, messing up with the social order. What about the intervention? Do we find Jesus being interventionist? When Jesus says to his disciples, "This is how you're meant to pray." Now remember, they knew how to pray. They prayed three times a day. They weren't stupid. He was telling them, "This is what we believe in." He said, "Forgive them this day their daily bread." In a context where people were being starved to death, where people, the majority of the people were subsistence farmers. 40% of what they had either went in tax to the temple or went in tax to Rome. So they were living off next to nothing. So when Jesus is saying, "Give them bread," he's intervening. He's messing with the economic system. And then it gets worse. "Forgive their debts." People were in debt to the Roman authorities, in debt to the temple authorities. Jesus is messing it up. He's saying, if you're going to be prophetic, if you're going to be a person who follows me, you've got to deal with the economic order that impoverishes and marginalizes and brutalizes people, not just only in the northern hemisphere, but within the southern hemisphere in terms of how we've rigged the economic system to keep the poorest people on the planet poor. Jesus is messing in that. We're messing with that in terms of his intervention within this, within the Lord's Prayer. But also we see Jesus in his ministry affirming the work of justice, affirming the good deeds that people do. When the disciples get it right, he praises them. And too often, when he encounters people who show real faith, he affirms them. When he sees people who are doing right, he affirms them. So if we are really committed to being prophetic and following Jesus, it seems to me there are three things that we have to take stock of here which are really, really important in terms of the prophetic discipline. The first thing is we need to hold our prophets to account. We can't have people standing up in church or in the community and claiming to have a prophetic word and have nothing to say about what's happening to children in school. We can't have people who say that they have a prophetic word and have nothing to say about gender injustice within our employment agencies, within our schools, and the double jeopardy that black women face in terms of race and gender discrimination throughout their lives. You've got to be able to speak about that. You can't say that you are a prophet and have nothing to say about the political world, about the way in which politics works within this. If you don't even know who's the Labour Party head, you're in trouble. You're in trouble. We've got to hold them to account and say, thank you for that word. But this was at best half prophet, and half prophet is no prophet at all. You're not engaging with the stuff that the prophets, you're not nabby. You're not dealing with the structures and the principalities and powers and intervening. You're going back in your car afterwards to your house. You're not on the front. That's not what, holding them to account. Yes. First thing. I think the second thing that we have to do, and this is obviously where my day job comes in, is we've got to ensure that people who claim to be prophets are educated. And I'm not saying they need to go to university and get a degree, but they've got to study to show themselves approved. Look, Isaiah was in the king's court. You can't be in the king's court if you can't read. He was in the king's court because he was an educated person. He understood the scripts, the language, the history. He was somebody who was intelligent. Now, I'm not saying intelligent is always equated with having qualifications. But Jamaicans have a history of talking about educated fools. You get an educated. My mother always used to say to me, stay sensible despite your education. She said, don't let them turn you fool. You know, so we know that. But we've got to ensure that we raise the standard for who is preaching and teaching about the prophetic. It's tragic in contemporary Britain. African Caribbean churches, in terms of my estimate, we only train up to university standard about 10% of our clergy and our prophets and our ministers in theological education. Now, we were worried about half profit. 10% profit is even worse. We've got to do something about the lack of theological education within the pulpit and amongst people who are claiming to be prophets. The third thing that we have to do, and I'm going to end with this because I know that the time is short, is we have to make sure that we listen to and work with those who are doing the work of prophecy within the church today, those who are telling us, as is the case with the organization you formed, The Well, that Christians have a social responsibility. You cannot be Christian and not engage with the injustice within this world. The Jubilee tradition that Jesus starts his ministry from in Luke 4 goes back to Isaiah, saying that, listen, the people in the Old Testament couldn't do this stuff because Isaiah was reflecting on the Levitical law, where every 7 years there's a sabbatical, every 49 years or 50 years, there's a jubilee when all the land that was taken from you was given back to you, where the land was fallow, where slaves were set free. They shouldn't have slaves in the first place. Slaves were set free and debts were cancelled. Jesus begins Jesus' ministry with that to remind us that we have to do the work of justice. So we need to make sure that we are following those people who are telling us then to be prophetic, to deal with the injustice, to deal with the inequality, to deal with the fact that we need to be inclusive people. Yeah. Race, class, gender, human sexuality should not be a barrier for people coming into the house of God and experiencing God's divine presence. That's an act of justice. Prophet, half prophet, is no prophet. Thank you.
That's good. Wow. What a powerful time of teaching from Dr. Robert Beckford. Thank you so much, sir. I hope it has enriched and recharged your life just like mine and getting you ready for the year ahead. Remember to send your prayer requests in. We're going to be praying for you across the day tomorrow and for the rest of Declaration, across all the workshops, and of course, right here at the live show. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Remember to join us the same time tomorrow, right here at 8 p.m. We're going to be diving into the subject of community and climate, and you do not want to miss this one. I've had the privilege of having an exclusive interview with Reverend Dr. Bernice King, the daughter of Martin Luther King. So tell a friend to tell a friend. You don't want to miss that interview. We'll see you tomorrow. We love you. God bless you. Check out the after parties. Good night.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, that's our God. Yes, our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, that's our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Stand against. What could stand?
The pandemic isn't over. Millions of people living in poverty are still trying to recover from the devastation of COVID-19.
People have lost loved ones, their homes, their jobs. Thousands can never go back to the lives they once had. Our mission is to follow Jesus where the need is greatest, responding to crisis and partnering with local churches to bring restoration to those living in poverty.
In partnership with Tear Fund, The Well seeks to encourage and empower those suffering the effects of the pandemic to discover for themselves the tools and the resources they need to recover together.
Please act now. We cannot afford to wait. Text RECOVER to 70122 to give £17 or visit tearfund.org/recover. Your gift could provide a family with health training and food support for 3 months. Give today and let's recover together from COVID-19. Thank you.
This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Joyce Meyer Ministries.
Hello and happy new year. Welcome to Enjoying Everyday Life. We're so glad that you've chosen to join us, and I think you will be today too. Joyce's teaching is going to encourage you no matter what challenges you may be facing right now. So get ready to start the day, the month, the year.